So invite your friends. There's a Facebook page for Revelation Live, and so you can invite friends to that. I would just ask that you prayerfully do that, because you know, sometimes it's annoying to people to get invitations to things that they know they'll never go to. But if the Lord tells you, I would just say invite them. So the other thing that I wanted to just mention here is the New Year's Eve. So excited about New Year's Eve. That's going to start at 5. If you are coming and haven't yet signed up for the potluck portion of that, could you go online to the Facebook event for that and just that'll make it a lot easier for Melissa Wood to know who's bringing what and what other fill-ins we need to do. So if you could go do that, that would be awesome. I think that Tom's coming up. Are you coming up? Okay. Okay.
A little organization here. My water. Notes are in the back. They were in the back aisle. Okay. It's Allie's birthday. I think we should sing her happy birthday. Can we sing a happy birthday? Is that okay? All right, birthday. We're so proud of you, Alia. You lead us in a lot of ways. And I was praying, I was asking the Lord, just like, can I have like a word for her? What do you see when you look at Alia? And he showed me, you look kind of a, I don't know, kind of a funny picture, but you, I don't know if you know about the cartoon Tarzan or the story Tarzan. You ever heard of Tarzan? You've heard of the book. Okay. So in Tarzan, I don't know very much about him, but I do know that he travels sometimes by grabbing onto a vine and swinging and then grabbing onto another vine and swinging. And the Lord showed me you doing something like that, and it was like over like a jungle and like, I just really felt like that God has given you an ability to really believe him and to hang on to things that might scare other people, but that's actually how you kind of move forward, and it's going to keep you really safe. So we just pray that for Alia, Lord, that you just continue to increase her faith, that she would do things that just are surprising to people because she has so much faith that she's able to just cover a lot of ground and be safe from the things that would kind of slow other people down or kind of trip them up. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Okay, so we're almost done with the Tabernacle of David must-haves, just in time to start a Rev class. And I really feel like what the Lord was telling me about another Rev class is that with some of this information about the Tabernacle of David, like really specifically studying some of the attributes of it, when we hit the book of Revelation, the book of Revelation is the best incentive the earth is ever going to see to do the Tabernacle of David. In fact, that's, you look, the prophetic passages about rebuilding the tabernacle of David are all kind of connected to, like, very real events happening in the book of Revelation, like Israel being joined, or the church in Israel being joined together as a bride, the shaking of Israel among the nations. Like, there's a ton of very intense things that will drive people into night and day prayer. So as we start studying the book of Revelation in this context, I think it's going to actually open up a ton of understanding for all of us. So I'm just kind of praying for that, and I'm going to pray for tonight. So Jesus, I pray that we would see the tabernacle of David as your plan for your government to start to manifest in the earth, to start to come and actually rule in the earth in the places that want it. In Jesus' name, amen. And I ask for tonight, God, wisdom and revelation, that you would anoint my speaking and anoint the hearing. And I pray that you would be the one, Lord, directing the events tonight by the Holy Spirit. We just yield to you, Holy Spirit, right now. Whatever you want to do, I want to do. Just help me to be sensitive. Help us to be sensitive to what you're doing and to yield to you. And I pray the whole night that we just, it just increases all the way till 1 a.m., just our awareness of your presence and our yielding to you and the sweetness that comes, Lord, from having the weight kind of off of our shoulders, the responsibility for everything that has to happen. We really want to partner with you and let you be the power and us be the ones that desire it. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so if you have notes, you're going to see that we only have a couple of these left. After tonight, we're only going to have two. That the tabernacle of David needs to be centered on Israel, and that it must be family-oriented. So I'll do those two in the next, you know, couple of midnight cries. But tonight we're going to talk about the fact that the tabernacle of David needs to be antiphonal. Now, if you've never heard the term antiphonal before, that might seem like just a really boring kind of statement. But it's really powerful when you start to connect with why the antiphonal nature of Jesus' government is so important. Because really kind of all the things that we're trying to organize Lighthop around, which is the release of ministries and people getting voices to speak and like finding that they're important, like that everybody's important in a body. Like the way that Paul described the church is like a body in 1 Corinthians 12. And he said that like there's a ton of parts that are all like, they're all important. And some of them need more honor than others. Some of them need more covering than others. But like there's no part of your body that you want to live without. The antiphonal nature, the back and forth. What I mean by antiphonal are two opposing voices. And in fact, there's a definition of antiphonal in item two, which is just the responsive alternation between two groups, especially of singers. And so I don't want to get lost in the language. I want to be real practical. So one of the issues that comes up when we're trying to build a house of prayer is that when you start to sense, hey, I want a prayer set or I want a worship set, that you kind of want to jump right into it. And one of the governors on that idea is, well, do you have a prayer leader to go with the worship leader? Do you have a worship leader to go with the prayer leader? There's a really specific reason why we don't want to build prayer sets without all of those pieces in place. And that's what I want to talk about tonight, why you can't really do the tabernacle of David by yourself. Like, you just can't. David hired 24,000 singers, musicians, and gatekeepers to keep night and day prayer going, to replicate what was happening around God's throne. We've talked a lot about that. I'm not going to develop that tonight. But it's important to understand why multiple voices are actually necessary. Without the multiple voices, you could do prayer. Like, there's lots of different kinds of prayer. But to do the specific kind of tabernacle of David prayer, you actually have to have at least two opposing voices. Ideally more, okay? And so that's what I want to talk about tonight. Now, God's government is antiphonal. And I'm going to try to stay pretty close to the notes tonight, because I felt like that's something that I'm just kind of endeavoring to do anyways, to stay a little closer to my notes. I like being led by the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit actually helps me write the notes too. So like sometimes I get real excited and I kind of abandon Holy Spirit plan A and get excited, and I don't necessarily like doing that. So Holy Spirit, help me to stay on Holy Spirit plan A. Okay, so the definition of antiphony is a responsive alternation between two groups, especially of singers. That's like the Merriam-Webster definition. Now, God's government is based on agreement and voluntary submission, like at the micro level, like in the leadership of our own hearts or in internal being, you know, who we are inside. So we're actually made triune. We're made in the image of God is the way that it says it in Genesis 1. And so we are body, like everybody touch your body for a second. I love this exercise. We are soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions. Go ahead and touch your soul for a second. It's a little harder to do, right? But you can think, like go ahead and think something. And you can feel, you're feeling something right now. And there's some things that we want to do. That's our will. Like just think about what you want to do. So you can kind of relate to your heart, not as easily as you can to your body. Like you can touch your body. But your heart, you kind of know what you're thinking, what you're feeling, and what you want to do. And then we're spirit. Now touch your spirit. Oh, that's like harder because your spirit is your innermost man. Like you feel the spirit in mostly kind of vague is not the right term, but like, it's like you sense your spirit. Like it's hard to identify exactly what's going on in your spirit most of the time. Sometimes you get some real clarity with your spirit, and that's important. Okay, and so God's government from that area, your triune nature, all the way to the macro aspects of God's government. By macro, I mean the big, like the literal beings that are going around his throne right now, listening to what he's saying, going out and executing his orders, releasing revelation of who he is. Both of those spheres and everything in between is led in an antiphonal way. I'm going to say that one more time. Your internal, all the way to the macro, like the literal, if we could just imagine God's throne room, like the White House, like the Senate, the Congress, the judiciary, like it's all run in an antiphonal way because it's all run as a voluntary agreement with God. God actually runs a voluntarily submitted government. Now, there's been an issue in God's government. There's been a rebellion. We call the original rebel Satan. And God has a plan. He's dealing with that rebellion. He's actually, because Satan did not want to live in voluntary submission to God's government, God is actually orchestrating the events to remove Satan from that government. Now, because God made everything and he is the source of life for everything that was made, and because his government is entirely based in love, the reason that it's voluntary is it's based in love. And so love requires a choice to love back or to reject love. Satan rejected it. But because it's voluntary, if you don't want to live with God, and he, because of his nature, he won't take second place. Like, it'd be untrue for him to bow to Satan's desire. It'd be untrue for him to bow to our desires. So if you don't want to live in truth with God, with him as Father and you as created or child, you know, him uncreated, us created, that's an option. You can choose, but then you have to go to the place that he's of fire. That's a very negative reality, even worse than the judgments that are described in the Bible. So like this, you know, the 100-pound hailstones falling out of heaven and hitting people and crushing them. That's not nearly as bad as an eternity in a lake of fire. In fact, all of those judgments are designed to get people to repent, to like change their mind before it's too late, before they actually have to go to the place where God isn't. The absence of God is a lake of consuming fire. Okay, so he runs his government based in agreement and voluntary submission, both at the micro level and the macro level, but we're actually in the middle of the process of him kind of sifting out who wants to live with him forever. That makes like our choices super, super important. Now, God has given a ton of dignity to mankind. Are you waving at me? Oh, okay, gotcha. I didn't know if there's a sound thing. Sweet. Okay, so yes, me too. I want to live with him too forever. Okay, and I just caught up. Now, at the micro level, a human being is at peace. That means experiencing the perfection of God's government. Now, God's government is government of peace. Jesus is the Prince of Peace. And the government's going to rest on his shoulders and increase forever and ever. And so if you're, you know that you're kind of lining up with God's government when you have peace in the inner man, like in your spirit, your soul, and your body, okay? Experience the perfection of God's government when his or her spirit, soul, and body are in unity. Now, we all kind of have moments that we kind of experience that, and we have moments where we kind of wander out of that, but that's what we should be growing into. We would describe this as the fruit of the Spirit. Like, if we're really kind of being set apart into this peace, we're starting to experience more and more of the fruit of the Spirit, and that is actually an existence of joy. And joy is defined as like, or at least I define joy as an innate sense of well-being. Like, you don't have to have great circumstances happening to have joy. Happiness and joy are two different things. But you can have an innate sense of well-being when you've got the fruit of the Spirit, the love, the joy, the peace, the patience, the kindness, the goodness, the gentleness, the self-control kind of manifesting in your inner man. And those things, they come from the Holy Spirit. They're fruit of the Holy Spirit, like inside of you. So when you get saved, when you accept Jesus' payment as the payment for your sins and you accept his leadership, that's what it means to get saved, is you take what he paid for, the infinite value of his perfect sinless blood being shed on a cross, the only man that should never have had to die. When you say, okay, I, because it was so unjust that he would die, because he lived perfectly in the leadership of the Father, because it was so unjust that he would die, it makes his blood infinitely powerful to pay for all the junk that we do. And so when you're like, okay, I'm willing to believe that, and I want to apply that to my mistakes, but part of the deal is, if you want to be in a relationship with Jesus, you actually have to come under his leadership all the way, because he won't occupy second place. And so a lot of people, they have this salvation experience, and no one tells them that there's this whole leadership aspect to it. And so they kind of assume, I'm good, and they just kind of go on, never really learning to submit to his leadership. They're going to be very surprised. In fact, there's lots of passages in the Bible that say, but I never knew you. Like, you never actually got close to me. And to know him is to submit to him because of the truth of who he is. Okay, so when you get into this process that you've selected him as your Messiah, as your Savior, and you're starting to come more and more under his leadership, then what should be happening is that you should be growing more and more in the fruit of the Spirit. Like, he's actually setting you apart, because the very first thing that he does is he sends the Holy Spirit, like uncreated God in the Spirit, inside of you. And so suddenly you have a connection to God by the Holy Spirit inside of you, and then you start to have a choice. Am I going to listen to the Holy Spirit? We call this prophecy. This, all that prophecy is I train my ear to listen to what God's saying, and when he says it, I'm willing to say it too, first to myself and to other people, and I want to not just be a hearer of the word, I want to be a doer of the word. So I start to actually live into the things that he's saying. When we do that, when we start to become prophetic like that, then we start to grow in the manifestation of the government of God from the inside out. Am I making sense? Okay, so this is really, really important, because this is basic salvation. Now, if you never got saved into this, that's okay. All you have to do is say, Jesus, I repent of my own self-leadership. I want you to be the leader, and I want to experience all of this good-sounding stuff, the peace, the patience, the love, the joy, the kindness, the gentleness, the self-control of your leadership, and I'm willing to try to lay down my leadership and follow you. That's what it means to get saved. Is there anybody here that wants to get saved that never got saved before? There's a lot of grace right this second. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Savior, if you just raise your hand, we'll pray it together. I just want to know if there's anybody here that needs to get saved. Okay, great. If you decide later on you need to get saved, come find me. I'll pray with you, okay? Because the stuff I'm going to talk about tonight, it's really for saved people. Like, all the benefits of it, all the power of it, all of the meaning in your life is connected to seeing God, hearing God, and agreeing with him, because you're called to be an important leader in all of creation forever. Okay, now I want to read 1 Thessalonians 5:23, which kind of wraps all these ideas together in one verse. And this is what it says. Now may the God of peace, like, God has many names. In this passage, he chose through Paul to call himself the God of peace. Sanctify you completely. That means set you totally apart, like totally change the nature of what you belong to. And may your whole spirit, soul, and body, that's that triune nature, be preserved blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So this all pays off at the coming of Jesus. Now, I believe Jesus is coming very soon. A lot of the trouble in the earth is related to Jesus coming very soon. And we want to grow in this reality, in this being set apart into an entirely different leadership scheme unto his coming, because he's coming to be an entirely different kind of leader. Now, this happens from the inside out. We're supposed to experience the leadership of God first by our spirit. Why? Why do we first experience it by our spirit? That's where the Holy Spirit was sent to. Okay, so if you're three parts, like you just imagine, like I got three monitors here, and they're all connected, and the Holy Spirit comes to this one first, then I'm going to experience the leadership of God here first. But let's imagine this is my heart, and that's my body. There's a process to move the leadership of the Holy Spirit from my spirit where I can barely relate to him. Like I can kind of like sense what he wants. Now, you know this, like if you've ever done something absolutely you were not supposed to do, maybe you didn't even know why you weren't supposed to do it, but you got this sick feeling deep inside your gut. Anybody ever experienced that before? That's you sensing your spirit. And the spirit's like, don't do that. You're grieving the Holy Spirit. Now, as you mature as a follower of Jesus, what you should be doing is talking to the Holy Spirit. You might be like, well, I talk and I don't hear anything. Well, that's a normal experience. It's just like getting to know anyone else. You have to spend some time learning to hear their voice. You learn their personality. The Holy Spirit's not an it. It's a he. He's a he. And he has an entirely, he's got the most interesting personality. And he woos us. And he loves to engage with us in a way that is joyful. And sometimes playful is probably not the right word, but like, interesting is probably the best way to say that. Like, he's got a sense of humor. He's got a personality. He's got, you know, a ton of wisdom. And he tells us the things that we need at the time we need it. But if you never talk to him, because his entire government, because the Father's entire government is based on voluntarily submitting to his government, if you never start the conversation, because the difference in power is so great. I mean, he's perfect in power. If he whispered something to us, we would have to do it. And so he waits for us to start to talk to him. Holy Spirit, what do you feel right now? Like, I'm thinking about Alia's birthday. I'm like, Holy Spirit, is there anything that I could, like, say to her that you're feeling? And he gives me a little, you know, a very faint, very vague image. And if I'm willing to say it, if I'm willing to take a risk and say it, then suddenly I'm giving the Holy Spirit a chance to let him partner with me and me partner with him. And I'll find out over time whether or not the thing that I felt like I saw him say in this very kind of vague way was right or wrong. Now, the Bible is very clear that we see dimly. Okay, actually, let's turn to 1 Corinthians 13. This is really, really important because so little is understood about the spirit of prophecy. There's a lot of anecdotal information, like if the prophet's wrong, they've got to get stoned. You know, there's really not a lot of prophets nowadays. There's a lot of non-biblical anecdotal information just kind of in the church right now. We need the spirit of prophecy right now, desperately. Now, this is not the message that I gave, you know, several weeks ago that the tabernacle of David must be prophetic, but it is directly connected to that because all prophecy, true prophecy, should be antiphonal. Everybody say antiphonal. It should actually have more than one expression in any given thing, okay? So, when we look in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. Now this is important because this is one of the most clear teachings the Bible gives on the spirit of prophecy is 1 Corinthians 12 through 14. And so we have to understand that all of us prophesy dimly. Now one of the first things that will cause a person to start to lose influence in my life is overconfidence in prophecy. If somebody's like, it has to be because I saw it, then I start to think that's so dangerous and so non-biblical. Like, if you want to grow in authority and you want to grow in influence prophetically, what you do is you recognize we all kind of see dimly. You say what you see. You don't assert it too much. Like, you don't demand that people understand what you're saying or agree with you. You just kind of throw it out there. And then you let the Holy Spirit alight on it and help other people agree with it. This is the way that God's government works, right? Because it is voluntary. But when people, me, like everything I'm going to say tonight is really stuff that I didn't learn in a book. I learned it the hard way. Like I learned it because I didn't understand this. Nobody ever taught it to me. And when you don't know a lot about it and you're kind of thrust into this much power, because this prophesying, like hearing what God says and then saying it, it's a ton of power. And the people that aren't familiar with it will start to give you a lot of attention, especially if you're confident. And I happen to be either graced with or hindered by an inordinate amount of confidence. So sometimes I sound like I know and it must be, and it's really just kind of my natural excitement, right? This is important to understand because a lot of people that are willing to try prophecy are kind of like that. Like they have a lot of kind of natural excitement. They're excited about it. They're excited that you're excited about it. And suddenly there's this potential that can grow within us to just think, well, if I thought it, that must have been God because I've been in this habit of trying to hear him. And now that I think it's God, I must believe it. Otherwise, I'm unfaithful. There's this massive trap in the spirit of prophecy if you don't understand it. And it's easy to believe more in your own faith than yield to God via the Holy Spirit. But if you've been prophesying for any amount of time, what you quickly learn is sometimes you're wrong. Sometimes you get it wrong. Sometimes you're right in what you see and you're wrong in what you interpret it to be. Sometimes you're wrong in what you see, but the general sense that you're getting from it is right. And if we stay soft and we stay willing to adjust, if we stay humble and aware that we're not supposed to actually be perfect at this, we're just supposed to be trying to be, like trying to grow in knowing who God is what I'm saying. Not actually trying to be perfect, but trying to be more and more aware of knowing who God is. And where we also recognize that God is doing this with a multitude of people around us, then suddenly we get a ton of unity. We get a bunch of like ability to say, I think this, and then to listen to somebody else say, I think this. This is the antiphonal nature of God's family. So if you just picture God like a dad in the center of a room and all of his children kind of surrounding him and saying what they see about dad, like this makes God actually quite happy when we're all like just trying to know more about what's in his heart, what makes him tick. And I see it from this angle and you see it from this angle and both of them are somewhat true. But if we both see dimly, if we're both not all the way next to him, there must be some more to know. This puts us in the position to really grow in the spirit of prophecy. But if I'm kind of at a distance and I'm like, it must be, and whatever anyone else says that doesn't totally agree with what I'm saying, it must not be, then that we don't ever have any ability to grow. We're just kind of stuck where we are. This is what makes the lack of antiphony so dangerous. In fact, the lack of antiphony, the lack of multiple angled revelations of who God is what led to the Tower of Babel. So if we go to the very last page of our notes. I'm going to stick to the notes, apparently, in a different way. Genesis 11:1. Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. That sounds great. That sounds like unity. They must have all been getting along really, really well. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And then they said to one another, come, let us make bricks, bake them thoroughly. They had brick for stone. They had asphalt for mortar. They said, come, let us build ourselves a city and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of men had built. Even there, it doesn't sound like that bad of an idea. Hey, why don't we make a city? That's except for the command to mankind just before this was the command to Noah. Go out, subdue the earth, be fruitful and multiply. Break up. They did exactly the opposite of what God was telling them to do, and they were all of one voice. So a lack of antiphony, a lack of being willing to entertain, okay, I know that I'm hearing something of the Lord, or at least I'm trying to, and I believe that your intentions are good and you're trying to hear something of the Lord, but you're hearing something different than I'm hearing. What that does is it keeps us moving closer and closer to the Lord if we're willing to do that. But if we're like, no, I'm getting rid of every voice that doesn't agree with me. I just want to kind of group up. Let's get in agreement. I'm tired of all this struggle of not agreeing. Let's just do something together in the name of God. What you end up with is a harlot, like wanting to do all the good things, but not in covenant to one man. Okay? This is really, really important because this is happening all over the earth right now. Now, to be spirit-led is to be prophetic. Oh, I missed the point about, I'm going back to page one of the notes. Okay, so the way that we're designed, the way that Adam and Eve were designed, they were supposed to be led by the spirit, the mind, will, and emotions. Remember, they didn't know good from evil when they were first made. So they didn't really have an opinion about the leadership of the Spirit. They're just kind of like, okay, the Spirit's saying we can eat from any of the trees. Good. You know, we don't need any clothes. Check. We can name some animals. Great. This sounds awesome. Like, they were totally satisfied. They weren't dumb. They just didn't have an opinion that differed from God. Their mind, will, and emotions were submitted to what the Holy Spirit called good. Now, if you remember Jesus, some Pharisees came to try and test him, or teachers of the law came to try and test him. They're like, good teacher, why don't you tell us? And he was like, do you know who you're talking to? There's none good but the Father. God is the only one who knows good from evil. That's the irony of the snake giving Adam and Eve the enticement to eat the fruit, is it was simply short-circuiting the very thing that God wanted to do always, which was lead them into the knowledge of good and evil over time as a dad leads a kid. So the enemy, he just took the promise that the Father had already given them and said, you can have it faster. And they were like, good, okay, we'll do it. And they lost all of it. And so when we get saved, we suddenly get a shot back into, by the Holy Spirit coming back in, we get a shot into doing what Adam and Eve were always supposed to do, which was submit the mind, will, and emotions to the heart, or to the Spirit, right? But this is hard because we don't have a real powerful sense of the Spirit right away. It takes some actual desire to want to listen to the Holy Spirit. We actually have to quiet down some other things in order to submit to the Spirit. But when a man is most at peace, when a man is most powerful, when a man is most happy, manifesting the fruit of the Spirit, gentle, kind, it's because he's found a way to get his mind, will, and emotion, what he thinks, what he's feeling, and what he wants to do, he's found a way to kind of quiet that stuff down and listen to the Holy Spirit. How do you do that? You say, Spirit of anger, go now in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, thank you for peace. You start talking to the Holy Spirit, and you start talking to your own soul. You prophesy over your own soul. You're like, yeah, it's not okay. You prophesy to the demonic forces that are trying to stir up your flesh. You say, get away from me, and you choose to try to the best of your ability to follow the Holy Spirit. Now, the more that you do that, the more better you get at it. The more better you get at it, the closer you get to God in your thinking, in the leadership of your heart, the more you get to see of God, the more authority you get, the more revelation you get. Does that make sense? This is how authority works in the Bible. Authority is produced by revelation. Revelation is gotten, it's gained, who make ascend the hill of the Lord? Clean hands and a pure heart. So doing the Sermon on the Mount, what it does is it actually gives us this exercise of putting away what the flesh wants, what the mind, will, and emotions want, kind of letting it settle down, and then trying to follow the Holy Spirit into something deeper than the law that Moses got written on some stone tablets. Okay? Now, the opposite of that is where the world is mostly going, which is called depravity. Everybody say depravity. Depravity is the opposite leadership scheme. It is the body, right? So in the correct one, the Spirit is where the information comes from God. We quiet down. We listen to the Holy Spirit. We let our mind, will, and emotions kind of submit to him. And then our body is submitted to our mind, will, and emotions. Like, I want to drink that, or I want to eat that, or I want to say that. And the mind, will, and emotions like, no. The Spirit's saying don't do that, right? So we got this correct order. We're making good choices, and we actually feel peace. The opposite of that is called depravity. What that is my appetites, what I want to eat, what I want to drink, what I want to see, what I want to touch, what I want to feel, that's what's kind of calling the shots. And my mind, will, and emotions are like, well, got a good point. That would be pretty cool. And this Holy Spirit is, or the Spirit, because generally when this is happening, the Holy Spirit's nowhere to be found. The Spirit is just dead and trailing behind. Does that make sense? We're really trying to reverse that. That's not good for you, and it's not good for the world. Depravity is like contagious, negative, and it's devoid of the Holy Spirit. Now, over time, what's going to happen is God is going to give places that don't want God over to that not wanting God. Like, and what that means is depravity is going to skyrocket. It's already happening. Can you see this? Because he's lifting his hand of restraint. So for thousands of years, ever since this choice was made available way back at the cross, God has had his hand of restraint on geographic locations generally. Now, sometimes he lifts his hand to show us what is really in the heart of man. Let's think of some examples of that. Like Nazi Germany would be a good example of depravity starting to rule as a governmental system. Does that make sense? Mass murder, like massive sexual, like terrible stuff, like all kinds of bad stuff starts to happen when depravity starts to be the rule of law. This is happening right now in our country. Like, we're not all the way there, but we are rapidly accelerating towards it. So if you want to be safe in that, you've got to find a different governmental structure to live your life by, internal, micro, all the way to macro. There's an amazing, glorious government operating right now, day and night. There's angels and elders declaring his worth and his beauty, like all taking turns antiphonally describing who he is, and we can step right into that. The more that we do it in the macro level, the easier it is to do it in the micro level, because you're actually asking for power that agrees with the way that you're created. Does that make sense? That's why generally you can't feel at peace in your sin. You're actually violating the very way you were made to live. If you feel that way, it's really easy to break with. You just repent. You just say, I don't want to do that anymore. Holy Spirit, tell me what to do. And you start to yield. Now, I've learned this the hard way because my marriage almost entirely disintegrated. Even though I was saved, I loved Jesus, I talked to him when I was in trouble, I just never asked him what he wanted me to do, and I never actually sat and listened for an answer. Sometimes I'd ask him what he wanted me to do, but I wasn't patient enough to actually wrestle through waiting for an answer. Now, when I almost lost Sam, I was suddenly faced with the reality that I had never really learned how to, like, submit to the leadership of God. And as soon as I started to do that, my marriage started to get healed. I started to get peace. Like, a ton of things started to come in line. This is really important. Now, each member of a man's body, like his spirit, soul, and body, it experiences. My body feels God differently. How many of you have ever been in a meeting and you kind of feel like a tingling sensation, or like you can feel like there's a presence in the room? You ever experienced that before? Just raise your hand so I know. Your body's relating to heaven or to God in that moment, but your mind relates to God entirely differently. You know, you're reading your Bible and suddenly you're like, whoa, that makes sense. All of a sudden, that passage that I've read 100 times suddenly makes sense. That's your mind relating to God. And then your spirit relates to God entirely different. You ever been like just praying something and suddenly you're like, shoo, you like feel it move through you. That's your spirit relating to God. And so all three of those members of your being, they are relating to the same truth, the same one God in three different ways. And when there's antiphony in your person, you start to experience a ton of acceleration in the knowledge of God. Does that make sense? You start to get unity in your spirit, soul, and body. But they're all experiencing different things and different realities. The government of God is the exact same way. That's why there are 4 gospel accounts. Like these amazing stories of who Jesus is. You know, this messes people up. People that study the gospel accounts, there's like, there's some discrepancies in there. There's like some incongruencies. And then you got this whole apologetics like movement that's like, well, you know, that really means this and this means that. Well, some of these discrepancies are actually intended to get us to understand that there are some things that if you really just take them in the main and plain, the only reconcilable issue is that two people saw the same thing from 2 different angles and we aren't quite all the way to the center where we could know for sure what those discrepancies are. This is the beauty of being in God's government. You will never be bored. You will always, forever, because he's infinite, he will never run out of new things to show us. But you've got to get in that process of being willing to yield your mind, will, and emotions to the Holy Spirit in the ways that you encounter conflict with other, especially with other people. Because around God's throne, there's multiple people describing who he is at any given time. When we start to experience this here on earth, if we don't have the Sermon on the Mount lifestyle, will generally split apart. It would be like, I can't reconcile it. It doesn't make sense to me. And we just don't have the bond. If we get in the Sermon on the Mount, suddenly we've got this bond with Jesus. And it's like, well, you're kind of heading on the same trajectory I am. I can live with you. I can listen to you. And I can try to tell you what I'm saying all the way until we get to that point. But what will break this up is demanding that someone else sees it our way. That will break it up every single time. So we got to get into the area where we understand, like, prayer meetings are one of the best places for us to kind of practice this, because you get a bunch of people with a microphone in hand. Have you guys ever watched people that haven't experienced the prayer room before? They come in for the first time. They see that microphone's sitting there, and they're like, I could preach for hours now that I have a microphone available to me. Almost everybody that knows God, experiences church in any sort of way, they have stuff inside of them they want to express. We're made to express who God is. That's what makes this so beautiful. And when I say this, I'm pointing to the place where this microphone sits, where we grab it and pray. It makes it so beautiful, but it also makes it so dangerous. That's why most churches you go to, you'll never experience like an open mic and you can just walk up and say whatever you want to. Like the only way this will work is for us to get understanding of how to maintain this voluntarily agreed to governmental structure. Like we actually have to study it out and get in agreement with it at the heart level. Otherwise, it won't work. It just won't work. And that's why most people won't do it. Most church leaders say, I'd rather not get some of what could come forward than deal with all the junk that comes with everything coming forward. And we don't want to do that. But we do want to get into the wrestle with the Holy Spirit. That's why it's called the generation of Jacob. So in Psalm 24, actually, let's go there real fast. Are you guys staying with me? Am I making sense? Psalm 24, I want to go to verse 3. And this is the question. Who can get close to God? Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is Jacob, the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face. Now, when you hear about a generation called a person, the generation of Jacob, you really want to find out what is this guy famous for? Like Jacob is famous for wrestling with God through the night and getting an entirely different identity. He went from being Jacob, the supplanter, the heel grabber, to being Israel, like God's people. He got that in a wrestle. This is a wrestle. If you want to climb God's holy mountain, you got to realize there's a bunch of other people that want to climb it too. And you're in a wrestle, not with them. You're in a wrestle with you. You're in a wrestle with yourself in order to be able to stay in it with the other people that want to be close to him. He is reestablishing a family, the family that he created in the garden, always intended for them to voluntarily submit to him as supreme leader, dad, who would tell us right from wrong along the way. And that's the process that we're supposed to be getting back into right now. But it takes the putting down of our mind, will, and emotions in order to do this. Okay. So let's go to page 2 of the notes. Sometimes God offends the mind to reveal where it disagrees with the leadership of the Holy Spirit. John Wimber is famous for this saying. God offends the mind to reveal the heart. Okay? And this is what it says in 1 Corinthians 2, 9-14. This is because our logic is not capable of keeping up with the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so different are God's ways from man's ways. That's in Isaiah somewhere. I can't remember ever the verse in Isaiah. If anybody knows it, call it out. Does anybody know the chapter of Isaiah? As high as the heavens are above the earth, so different are God's ways from our ways. Okay. You can look it up on your Bible program on your phone. This is what it says in 1 Corinthians 2, 9-14, though. But as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. But God has revealed them to us through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man except the spirit of the man which is in him? He's saying the Spirit actually has a better handle than your mind, will, and emotions do. Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. Like you can't even honestly know what's available to you lest you yield to the Holy Spirit, who's hard to hear intentionally. You'd be like, well, that would take a lot of time. Like it would actually take a lot of wrestle, a lot of pain. I'd be in situations that were risky and I'd want to do what made sense to me. And you're saying I'd have to kind of wait and listen to the Holy Spirit. And I'm saying, yes, you would. That's what got Adam and Eve off track in the first place, was the impatience of not wanting to wait on a father to tell them what to do. So if you got saved, if you took that infinite, priceless, precious blood, applied it to your life, said, I sign up for your leadership, Jesus, he leads one way. He only leads one way. He doesn't lead in your impatience. He only leads in patience. And sometimes he's causing us to just simply have to be patient. Some of you right now, I just hear the Holy Spirit saying, some of you are in situations right now and you feel like I need an answer now and it's not coming and I'm just going to have to do what makes sense. And he's saying, don't do that. Trust me. I can keep you. I will hold you. Wait to hear from me. Give me a chance to talk to you. I'm unlocking something right now in your life. And if you'll yield, you'll benefit from it forever. But if you just press through this one like you have the other ones, you won't get the benefit of it. And there comes a point where I'll stop trying to woo you into it. That's for somebody. All right, so now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. They're foolishness to him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. This reality, it requires so much humility. Like, we really have to say, I don't know. We have to be willing to say, I don't know. I don't know what the Spirit is saying, and I know the Spirit knows more than I do, and I'm going to try to not do anything until I hear the Spirit speak to me. This is the weakness that David chose that made him the king that all of Israel is hoping that the fruit of his body will come back and lead them. Because he's so different from every other king that Israel had, like, he actually did this as a lifestyle. He did the Sermon on the Mount as a lifestyle. And that's why we hear about David's key and we hear about David's tabernacle. We hear that Jesus is going to sit on David's throne because David organized his government around this voluntary, submissive, trying to see what God is saying, declaring it, and then actually trying to live in agreement with it. This is what the whole tabernacle was about. This is why we're actually trying to duplicate David's tabernacle, because this will make us safe when all of the world is going into depravity. Because we're actually manifesting a government that's led by the Spirit. That means David's tabernacle must be prophetic. David's tabernacle must be antiphonal, okay? It must be ordered. Like, all these things are starting to come together. Do you see what I'm saying? Because we're starting to understand that David's tabernacle is simply the government of God. And if you're going to take the time and the effort and the expense to do it, you might as well do it the way that the government's supposed to work. Like, the way the Constitution is written, okay? And so, prophetic, absolutely everything that David's tabernacle was about prophetic. That means it was all about risk. That means it was all about patience. That means it was all about doing very strange things in the logic of man. A lot of the things David did, no other king ever would have done them. Saul would have never done them because they made no sense. Like, they weren't smart. They weren't good decisions, but they were God decisions. And he gets to say, okay? But the natural man can't receive this. Like, this is foolishness to the natural man. Acts 16, 7 to 9. This is Paul. This is one of the most prophetic people to ever step foot on the planet and write about it and see it in the Bible. I mean, Paul was incredibly prophetic. Incredibly. And filled with power. Like, he touched people. They got healed. He got bit by the snake. He shook it off. He didn't get hurt. I mean, he was walking in a ton of agreement with God. And this is his testimony. After they had come to Mysa, they tried to go into Bithynia, but the Spirit did not permit them. So Paul was like, we're going to go to this place. And the Spirit was like, hang on a second, Paul. Maybe you don't know something right this second. Like, Paul thought this is what we're supposed to do. And the Spirit was like, not right now. So passing to Mysa, they came down to Troas. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man of Macedonia stood and pleaded with him, saying, come over to Macedonia and help us. Paul got corrected by the Holy Spirit. And he's open about this many times. 2 Corinthians 2, 12 to 14. Furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel and a door was opened to me by the Lord, I had no rest in my spirit. Listen to what he's saying. Because I did not find Titus, my brother, but taking my leave of them, I departed for Macedonia. So when we put these two passages together, we find out Paul felt like, I know I'm supposed to do something. This seems best to me. And then I got no rest in my spirit. There's no unity in my mind, will, and emotions in the spirit. And suddenly I'm finding out I'm getting corrected. The Lord actually had a different idea that didn't make sense to me. This is really important. He's one of the pinnacles of us understanding what it looks like to walk in agreement with God. And if he's like, there were some times I thought the best thing to do was this, but the Holy Spirit was saying something entirely different. And out of that came a testimony of the increase of churches, the increase of understanding God. Now, thanks be to God who always leads us in triumph in Christ. This is his testimony at the end. He's like, I was wrong. The Spirit corrected me. Thanks be to God. I'm glad he did. He always leads us in triumph and through us diffuses the fragrance of his knowledge in every place. Just listen to that language. Through us, it's like a diffuser. Have you ever been in a room with a diffuser? It's like, there's something, where's that at? Where, something is in here, it smells good. Like, you don't know exactly where it's at, but you can get a sense. He's saying this is the way that it works. This is why the antiphonal nature is so important. This is why it's so important that if I pray something here and the Holy Spirit sings something here, between the two, if I'm willing to yield, if I'm not just waiting for the next thing that I'm going to say, if I'm actually willing to listen, suddenly I get a ton more revelation of God's heart. If we're willing to yield, we get more. If we're not, you can come and do these prayer meetings and never listen to anyone else. If you do that, you're short-circuiting the entire plan to get you in agreement with a government that is going to run this way forever. Forever. Okay, turn with me for a second to Revelation 4. Actually, at the bottom of page 2 of the notes. I'm accidentally right on my notes. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Okay, so at the macro level, this exact same thing works, which was the point of the notes being right here right now. We see a similar leadership structure to what's supposed to go on in our heart happening around the throne. Those closest to God, the seraphim, in the Revelation 4 throne room, who has the most authority next to the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit? Seraphim. They are the closest. They see the most. They're declaring holy, holy, holy day and night. Now out from there, there's revelation is spread out and there's authority that is distributed based entirely on what you want. Do you hear what I'm saying? If you want to get close to that place, Jesus would say, come as close as you want. And if I said, Jesus, I want to be at your right or your left, what would his answer be? Anybody know? Can you drink the cup and be baptized with the baptism? This is what James and John, the sons of Zebedee, asked Jesus. Their mom came to him. They came to him, according to the gospel accounts. Both they did it and their mom. They really wanted to be important. They knew Jesus was the King of Kings. They knew he was going to come and manifest an entirely different government. They're like, we're actually on the inside with a guy who's more powerful than Caesar. Let's ask him. And they went to him. They're like, can we sit at your right and your left? Can we have a ton of authority? He's like, can you drink the cup and be baptized with the baptism? Can you live like I live? If you want to live where I live, you need to live like I live. He didn't say no, it doesn't work that way. Now, when they said that and their friends heard about it, their friends got mad. And they're like, what are you guys doing? Trying to elevate yourselves above us. And Jesus says, you don't understand at all the way that my government works. If you try to elevate yourself, to really elevate yourself to be like me, is to serve everyone else. The only way this works is if you want to be the greatest, you have to be the servant of the most. That means you're willing to go through this wrestle. You're actually willing to get revelation and release it and not establish who you are in it. Do you hear what I'm saying? That means you get the greatest treasure and you could use it for what you wanted to and you give it away freely and you let other people recognize whether or not you're actually close to him and he will establish you over time. This is what happened to David. This is what the entire tabernacle is for. But you can violate this so easily and not even realize it. You start to assert your leadership. You start to assert your authority and you short circuit the whole thing. You lose all authority. This is what Saul did. Saul was anointed. He was invited to be king. He was told what to do. And he started to take it upon himself to do what made sense to him. And then he had to start demanding that people recognize him as king. And then he had to start killing people that wouldn't or that he felt were a threat to him. This is the way of depravity. It actually, this self-assertion will take us into depravity because it short-circuits the leadership of the Spirit. It puts it on what we think is happening. And then pretty soon, our appetites, they get a pull on us and we start to go that way. Now, this is the way God's government works. Four living creatures, each having six wings, were full of eyes around and within. They do not rest day or night saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, they initiate. This is what gives them the authority. This is why I can say with clarity, they have more authority than the elders in this situation because they're initiating worship. Revelation will initiate desire. That's a good way to say it. Why? Because everybody's invited to revelation. The only thing hindering your authority, the only thing hindering your revelation is you. Your mind, will, and emotions. How far do you want to go? Well, It looks pretty costly. Yeah, absolutely. But the Holy Spirit does all the work. You just do all the wanting. Well, the more I want it, the more people get upset. Like, this is something that I did not learn in a book. I thought when God gave me revelation, everybody would be so excited because, you know, it's like true. But they're not. A lot of people get mad. They start to say, no, did God really say? This is what the devil says. Did God really say? And they start to resist you. And Jesus is like, that's what you wanted. You want to be like me, right? Like when Jesus was done preaching, did he have like, he's the best preacher of God ever. What kind of crowd did he have when it was all done? 11, right? 12, but one of them was like in with the guys that were trying to kill him. Do you want to be like Jesus? Like, do you really want to be important forever? Because this is what has to happen. You have to suddenly start to place your life in the kingdom that's coming and take out all the reward from the kingdom that's here right now. If you do this, you will be so disruptive to the earth. The earth controls people by promising people stuff for their loyalty. You start a lovesick person that's actually got this in their mind, they can't be controlled. Like, they got nothing to lose and everything to gain. This is freedom in a government run by depravity. But if you won't break from it, if you won't break from the promise of recognition, honor, authority here, now, demanding people recognize you as an authority, what will happen is that forever you will cost yourself real authority forever. He's coming really soon. And if you buy into his leadership structure, what you suddenly find is the same thing that Paul found, the same thing that John found, the same thing that Peter found. I'm free. You can't kill what's already dead. I got nothing to lose. I'm living in the eyes of one, and he's going to show up, and when he does, I will never regret living that way. I mean, there's coming a day, I believe in just a few years, when he's going to split the sky. And in all of that glory and power and magnificence, there are going to be people, according to the Bible. Turn with me to Matthew 24. Listen to what I'm saying. I love you. I'm trying to help you. That's not where I was thinking. Where was it? Holy Spirit, where was it? Oh. Sorry, Revelation 1. Thank you, God. Verse 7. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Why? Why will every tribe of the earth mourn? Because when they see him in his brilliant, perfect, powerful beauty, they're going to see a ton of people get closer and closer to the thing that would satisfy every human heart forever, and they won't have the capacity to get near him. They'll mourn. They'll cry. They'll cry. I could have chosen him. I had all these opportunities to actually choose his leadership, to submit to him, and I didn't. And now, a billion years from now, I will feel it. A trillion years from now, I will feel it. Now, there'll be joy in heaven. I'm not saying that heaven is miserable, but they'll always be aware of what they could have had. Like, always. He warns about it over and over and over in the Bible, over and over. Gnashing of teeth in the outer darkness. He says that I'll say, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who practice lawlessness. And they will be surprised and upset forever. I mean, how many years of disappointment have you endured? 10? 20? 5? 1? Imagine a million. Just imagine it. I mean, the Bible says this. Do you know that the Bible says this? It's not a utopia where everybody wears the same white t-shirt and they all just kind of la 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 and nobody cares about anything. The Father's going to wipe away every tear from every eye after a 1,000-year reign of Jesus turning the earth back to the Garden of Eden. There will be tears on the saints for at least 1,000 years. Just imagine 1,000 years in the face of the, 44 that I've lived. If we really believe this, we would make decisions entirely differently. Entirely. But do we believe it? Do we believe it enough to actually invest our emotions into it? It's one thing to invest your money into it. That takes a lot. It's another thing to invest your time in it. That takes a lot. But man, it's everything to actually submit your dreams, the things that he's promised you. This is what David did. David was promised he would be king when he was a little kid. It took like 20 years for him to get it. But the entire process, the story of David's life, the greatness is not his righteous living. The greatness of David is not in his massive wisdom. The glory of David's life is in his submission, in his humility, in his weakness, in his actually saying, God, is it time? Should I go up? And God's saying, no, take Hebron. I've been waiting 20 years to be king of all of Israel. I could take it right now. The guy that's in charge right now, I could easily defeat him. And God's like, no, take Hebron. Trust me. I know what I'm doing. I'm the dad. You're the kid. Right. Yes. It's going to be this way forever. Get used to it now. If you get used to it now, you'll be great forever. Jesus did this perfect from the manger. From the manger. He did only what he saw the Father doing. Now, we do this not alone. We do this antiphonally. In fact, Jesus, he lived with the antiphony of the Spirit and the Father. They're the three in one. There's multi-membered unity in the Godhead itself. I see this. This is what the Spirit is saying. I'm going to do it. I'm going to agree with it. Do you remember him in the Garden of Gethsemane? He saw it a little differently. Father, is there any way this cup could be taken from me? And the Spirit says, no. I yield. I know that you see it. Can we yield? Can we be that humble? Can we be that risky? It's got to be antiphonal. I mean, when you start to do this, I've started it with kids lots of times. The temptation is to take away some of the steps so that it's not so risky, so it's not so awkward, so that, you know, nobody's embarrassed when you ask them to sing. Let's just have them pray. You know, that's like the tabernacle. We'll play some music, have them pray. It's not the same. You got to have the risk. You got to have the awkwardness. You got to have the, is it going to agree? Is it really going to work? That's the point. The point isn't that we have some good music or that we say some good prayers and it all kind of swells sometimes. We feel it. None of that really matters that much. What matters is my heart changing? Am I actually saying something, taking a risk in it? And then when somebody else says something and I'm like, that doesn't quite agree with what I just said, like, what do I do with that? What if it doesn't? What if nobody has anything when I pray? Is that a bad prayer? What if I'm the musician and somebody's praying and I don't have a song? Does that make me a bad musician? Or am I willing to get in the mix of this, the risky, messy mix of it, be antiphonal and see what the Holy Spirit is willing to do with a yielded, humble person that just is willing to admit, I don't know it all. It's so hard because we all want to ramp up and act like we are qualified, but all of us. It's the only kind of people there are. That's it. There's got no other kind to work with. And we're coming to the point, do you hear it in the nations? I mean, just look at what's happening in the White House right now. Do you hear it in the nations? These claims of qualification that are so ludicrous. So, I don't know if I could even say the word. You say asinine in church? Like, it's ridiculous. I don't think that's a swear word, right? Yeah. I don't know. I didn't mean to swear if I did, but it's ludicrous, the claims of qualification where there's clearly no qualification. This is the delusion that is flooding the earth right now. We want to go in the opposite way. I've got no qualification to stand here and teach you the Bible. I'm a geologist, for real. I've never gone to seminary. Nobody's ever taught me the Bible. I like learned it kind of in my, you know, sunroom over the course of several years asking God to give me revelation. And so for your own safety, don't take what I say as like gospel. Find it out for yourself. This is the true nature of the antiphonal revelation of God. Do you want it? me telling it to you, even if I was the most qualified seminarian with a PhD, an MDiv or whatever, if I'm just giving you what I think and you don't do anything about it, you're falling into harlotry. It would help you none. None. Now, even the seraphim see dimly relative to God. I was at a training once. Actually, you know who taught me how to prophesy? It was Jessica Concannon. A lot of you guys know Jessica Concannon. I didn't really know anything. I had prophesied accidentally. I didn't really recognize it as prophecy. I went to a street ministry training, and there's this, you know, in my mind, she was a little kid. I don't know how old she is now, but she was pretty young when I first met her. And she was like, how prophetic are you on a scale of 1 to 10? And I'm in a room, and I'm thinking, I'm not even prophetic enough to know how prophetic I am. Like, I must be like a 0, I guess. Right? And then there were some other people that were pastors, and they were like, you know, I think I'm a 9. And so if we just put, you know, like Tom's 0, the other pastor 9, compared to God, who's infinite in clarity, we all see dimly. Even the seraphim see dimly. He's infinite. He's the only infinite uncreated one. He's the only one like him. There's no one else is uncreated. The Father, Son, and the Spirit, that's it. And so everything else, what's the difference between, what's one less than infinite? Infinitely less. Infinitely less. So even the seraphim, listen, this is what it says in Isaiah 6:2-4. Above it stood seraphim. Each one had 6 wings. With 2, he covered his face. Why? Why did the seraphim take 2 of their wings and cover their face? Now remember from the last passage, they're covered with eyes. They actually cover their face and their body. They cover everywhere there's eyes. They can only handle so much revelation of who God is. So this is the picture we get from the book of Revelation of God's government. He's so beautiful. He's so glorious. He's so magnificent. He knows exactly what to do at any given time. He knows exactly how to fully satisfy your heart to the maximum capacity that you could possibly handle at any given time. Have you ever had this happen where you're like connecting with God for a second? And you're like, suddenly you got to pull away. And you're like, why did I do that? Why did I stop talking to God? It's because you reached max capacity. You really did. So what you pray at that moment is like, God, give me an increased capacity to stay with it with you. If this is happening to you, that's a really good season. Stay with it. Stay with it. Don't get into condemnation. Just stay with it. I want more. I want more. I want more. He'll grow your capacity like a wineskin. I was going to say something great, and I just forgot what it was. I'm going to read the verse. One cried to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. So this is the picture. This is what I'm trying to say. The picture we get are the seraphim getting glimpses of this perfect satisfaction. And they uncover their eyes for a minute. They see it. It comes into their frame. They cry out like it's a reaction and a desire and a want. Holy, holy, holy. They're saying all kinds of things. They're giving thanks, praise. In this case, they are saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Like they're seeing his desire because he's actually, his throne is movable. And he's there talking with Isaiah. And the robe, the train of his robe is filling like this picture. Like, and they're saying, oh, it's so beautiful how he loves the earth. Like in this moment, they can only take so much. They cover up their eyes. And another one is like, I see it too. Bam! They release it. Now, in the throne room in heaven, the elders are taking part in this. And when they get an earshot, they look and they release. This is antiphonal. This is why David set up his tabernacle the way that he did. Now, proximity and the release of revelation are what produce authority. I'm going to take about, I'll say 5. That's actually like 10. Can you guys stay with me for another 10 minutes? Okay. The proximity and release of revelation are what produce authority. Antiphony is ordered. So the seraphim are actually, they are higher in authority. This is important to understand. Now it's voluntarily recognized in the throne room. Like the elders are actually waiting for the seraphim according to the passage. Whenever the seraphim say, whenever the living creatures say, then the elders, bam. And so how do we get a sense of where is authority and who's leading this and how do I come into it? Watchman Nee wrote an amazing book called Spiritual Authority. Actually, he spoke these words. He taught and somebody wrote it down and turned it into a book. This is a great picture of the way that this works. But the way that authority is recognized or supposed to be in the body is voluntarily asking the Holy Spirit, where is authority in the room? Where is authority right now? Like, what's my role in the authority? What's the role of the other people in authority? And then we voluntarily submit to the authority that God is establishing in the midst of a people. This is so risky. This is why almost no church ever does it this way. They start telling you, I am the pastor, these are the deacons, this is the bishop, this is what we do, you'll listen to us, this is the only way it's going to work. This is not the authority structure described in the Bible at all. We have to understand there are positions that are important. There are actually gifts that are assigned until what? Turn with me for a second to Ephesians 5. Sorry, I just kicked. Ephesians 4, I'm sorry. Verse 11. Actually, verse 10. He who descended is also the one who ascended. This is talking about Jesus. He went, preached freedom to the captives in the abyss, far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he himself, Jesus, he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, for the equipping of the saints and for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come to the unity of the faith and knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. What Paul was saying, God gave position until we can get mature enough to actually do this thing, antiphonally, every part doing its part, mutually submitting to each other and letting the established order of God be released. This is what pastor, prophet, teacher, evangelist, this is what the fivefold that so many want to use as a pyramid structure to keep things in line. What it's actually supposed to be is a service structure in order to feed people so that everybody comes into their voice and their ministry. This is what God is talking about right now. He wants us released into ministry, but for this to work, the reason almost no one else does this is because it's so easily violated, because it's all based in voluntary submission. But there is a cost for being in a company of people and not voluntarily submitting. I want you to turn with me for a second to Acts 5. Almost done. Thank you for staying with me. When a company of people starts actually doing this, starts actually valuing it, what do we call it? The upper room in Acts 2. Okay, we'll wait for the power to fall. Okay, we're going to try and see what's happening around the throne. We're kind of waiting. We know what we're supposed to do. It doesn't make any sense, Jesus, why we're just sitting here. It's like day 6. This guy stinks. I don't think he took a shower today. Why does that lady screech when she talks? Okay, how long are we going to pray like this? This makes no sense, Jesus. We just saw you ascend. You've got all the authority. Go and make disciples. Wait. Why are we waiting? Fire falls. Wind blows. Thousands get saved. Whoa! God's glory is manifesting in our midst. We start sharing all things in common. Okay, it suddenly starts to make sense why Jesus wanted us to wait for his actual power to be the people that we're supposed to be. But in the midst of this company, there are some people, they haven't submitted to this idea. It's not dangerous for the company of people. It won't hurt the disciples, won't hurt anybody except for the people that are caught up in this and not valuing this idea that it is only going to work one way, not Peter's way, not John's way, not Paul's way, the Holy Spirit's way. Verse 1 of Acts 5, but a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira's wife sold a possession. He kept back part of the proceeds, his wife also being aware of it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit and keep back part of the price of the land yourself? While it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not your own control? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied to men, but to God. Then Ananias, hearing some words, fell down and breathed his last. So great fear came upon all those who heard these things. This is the danger of not falling into the antiphony. Like, we have to get to the place where we're like, okay, I know I'm hearing what the Lord is saying. I'm not totally sure, but I'm willing to say it. So if Ananias and Sapphira would, in this situation would have been like, you know, I'm not really feeling giving the whole thing. I feel like, you know, I'm hearing the Holy Spirit tell me to release this. And they in the company of people, say what they see and let the other people say what they saw. Suddenly, there's a ton of safety. But keeping it separate, keeping it secret, keeping it apart was suddenly incredibly dangerous because the glory of God was manifesting on a people that wanted the government of God. The government of God is uncompromising. He rules with a rod of iron. And this is what Peter's trying to say. Like, you don't understand the glory that's coming, that's manifesting here. It's not up to me. If it were up to me, it might be different, but it's not up to me. It's up to him. We're all yielding to him. We're all trying to stay in it together. It says that they were, let's go back a couple pages. Go back to Acts 2. This is after the fire fell and the wind blew. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship in the breaking of the bread and in prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done among through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common. They sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as anyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple. This doesn't mean that they all said the exact same thing. It means they stayed together in trying to hear what the other was saying. Now turn with me for a second to, let's go back to the notes for a second. I'm going to wrap up right now. I'm only 5 minutes from when I warned you. Okay. I want to go to yielding in the, let's go to page 4 of the notes. Yielding in the antiphonal nature of prophecy allows God's order to be established voluntarily by individually recognizing proximity to Jesus. This is what was happening with the apostles. There were 120 in the upper room, and suddenly, like, they're like, okay, we're going to follow the apostles' doctrine. They are the ones that were like, hey, let's wait for the power to come. And they stayed in it because those guys had the vision. Now, what broke this safety? Do you guys know? Go to Acts 6 for a second. Now in those days, this is verse 1, when the number of the disciples was multiplying, I mean, there's a ton of power on the church. They're doing this. Ananias and Sapphira have perished. They've been arrested. They got free. There arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of disciples and said, it's not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Suddenly they were like, do you guys know who we are? It broke everything. Do you know that the church, Stephen was martyred right after this, and the church scattered. The only people left in Jerusalem were those 11, or those 12. That's it. They suddenly were like, I'm going to assert my authority. I'm tired of dealing with this petty stuff about who gets what and what we did. I'm just not going to do it. I'm going to spend my time in the Word. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm just getting convicted right now. I'm going to spend my time in the Word and the study. I'm going to do the important things that everybody's following. You guys know who I am, and it broke everything about the community, destroyed it. They were suddenly not safe anymore. Do you know that before this, they were in the only city that it was illegal to be a Christian on the entire planet? Jerusalem was the only place you couldn't be a Christian. Like, they wanted to kill him. And Jesus started the church there, and he made so much power manifest on them. It says none of the rest dared join them, but in the whole city esteemed them highly, but many were added to their number. There was so much power resting on them that it was like manifesting salvation and safety. It was a city of refuge right in the middle of Jerusalem, and they broke it by asserting their leadership over the community. Like, we got to understand, you can't assert. If you self-assert, you suddenly have no authority. And when you have no authority, you have no revelation. When you have no revelation, you've got no protection because you're suddenly out of agreement with what God wants to do. So we have to go in the opposite spirit. We do what Jesus did. We do what John the Baptist did. So if we go back, right up at the top of page 4 of the notes, this is what John the Baptist said. Now, John was the greatest prophet up until his day, according to Jesus. They came to John and they said, Rabbi, he who is with you, this is Jesus, beyond the Jordan, to whom you've testified, behold, he is baptizing, and all are coming to him. And John answered and said, a man can receive nothing unless it's been given to him from heaven. You yourselves bear witness that I said, I'm not the Christ, but I've been sent before him. He who has the bride is the bridegroom. But the friend of the bridegroom who stands and hears him rejoices greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. Therefore, this joy of mine is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. John's ministry was intentionally one of decrease. Do you know that they came to John? They said, John, who are you? Are you the Messiah? Nope. Are you Elijah? You know, John knew who he was, but he never self-asserted. He said, no. You're the prophet. No, I'm a voice in the wilderness. When he said, I'm a voice in the wilderness, he was quoting the passage about the forerunner of the Messiah. He knew exactly who he was, but he was saying, I don't need to tell you who I am. Do you know who I am? Do you have enough revelation to recognize in the word who I am? And are you willing to come to me that you might get ready to receive the man that I'm warning you about? Because I'm telling you, you think I'm intense? I'm not even worthy to hold his sandals. He's not coming to warn you. He's coming to baptize you with the Spirit and with fire, and he does not compromise. He's got his winnowing fork in his hand. He's going to thoroughly clean out his threshing floor for real, and there will be real cost. Repent, for the day of the Lord is at hand. Don't play around with this. This is not neutral information at all. I've seen a lot of lives really actually hurt by the Tabernacle of David because it is not neutral. It is wedding information. If you start to play with this thing and then back away, what happens is it affects all of your relationships. It really does. It really does. You can't play around with it. You either have to do it or don't. Hot or cold is what Jesus said. Laodicea, you're playing around with it. You're marked enough for all the persecution. You got not enough power to endure it. That's why he hates lukewarm. It makes him sick to his stomach because you got enough of him on you to get marked for persecution and not enough agreement with his government to actually be safe in the persecution. This is what broke in Jerusalem. Boys, did you not remember? I told you, if you want to be the greatest, serve the most. Why are you complaining about the widows? This is your chance to be great forever. Come into agreement. I'm preaching to myself. I hope you know this. Because the last week, I just wanted to check out and just do my thing. And I'm suddenly realizing that's not an option. I got to get into the prayer meetings. And I got to get my soul under control, submitted. It's the only way this will work. And it's worth it because he's coming. He's really coming. He's really got his winnowing fork in his hand. He's really going to clean out his threshing floor. Do you see it? Do you see it? One more thing. Stay with me just a couple more seconds. You'll be glad. Okay, turn to page 5 of your notes. David's tabernacle, David got this. There was not a better musician in Israel. David played and spirits left. Like, this is the testimony of the Bible. David was an amazing musician. But he wrote a bunch of songs, a bunch of prayers, and he submitted them to the chief musician in the tabernacle. I mean, 50, at least 50, I think it's 55 of 150 psalms are addressed to the chief musician. Why? Why did David not just go in there, dude, I got another song. It's going to be great. You guys are going to love this one. Remember when Saul was so upset and I played and the spirit left? You guys want to see something amazing? He didn't do that at all. He got a revelation from the Lord and he wrote it down and he brought it to the chief musician. He said, do you see this too? Will you sing this? This is the king of Israel who started the tabernacle. He took all of his wealth and put it so that the temple could be built. And he submitted his music to the chief music. I mean, it just like blows my mind. But he did that because this is the way the government works. We have to understand that the order of our roles. Now, this is really practical. Because I've seen meetings get out of control because somebody feels unimportant. And they come up to the place where they're supposed to pray, and they just start belting out a song. It's got nothing to do with what the spirit of prophecy is doing. It's got everything to do with them feeling unimportant and wanting to use their strongest gift in front of everyone. It violates everything about the room. Sometimes a worship leader's like, I wish I could pray, and they want to pray out from this place. Now, I'm not saying there's sometimes it's appropriate. There's sometimes the Holy Spirit is telling us to do this. But only you can know what the Spirit is saying to you at any given time. Sometimes you just want to be important in the role that you don't have right that second. This is all about bringing our heart under control. I do this all the time. I do this all the time. I just want to admit before you. I stand up to the mic, and I'm not praying to Jesus. I'm actually praying to the room. This is very negative. You don't want to do that. It violates everything that's going on in this room. But there's nobody that can enforce that over me except for me. I'm the only limiting factor in how great I will be forever. Only I could really secretly know inside why I'm doing what I'm doing. Only you know what you're doing. So this is a voluntary thing. It's a voluntary submissive thing. But you can be in this company of people. This is the parable of the 10 bridesmaids that Jacob was preaching about last week. You can be in this company. We could all be going after this together, but there's coming a moment you're going to find out whether or not you got oil or not. This is the oil. This is the internal press of submitting to the antiphony of it. Am I willing to be less important so God can make me important? When you're invited to a wedding feast, this is the parable Jesus said. Don't take the place of most importance. Take the place of least importance. Then he who is the honored guest, when he comes, he'll take you and lift you up to an elevated place. But if you put yourself in the elevated place, he'll, hey, say, friend, could you move? There was somebody who actually cared about the way that I live. It's going to happen. All right. Elena, can you come back in? There's some more in the notes. Nobody is good at this. Zero people are good at this. But we can be. And it's painful. And the only way that this will work is a prayer room. This is why night and day prayer is actually the only plan Jesus has to return. Because you could only get ready for him to return by asking for it intentionally all the time. How deep is the stain on my heart? Like, how deep does my self-leadership go? Like, it's DNA level deep. We inherited a really big problem from great-great-great-grandpa Adam and great-great-great-grandma Eve. Jesus paid for us to get all the way ready. He paid for us to be sons and daughters of the Most High. He paid for us to not need apostles, pastors, prophets, teachers, evangelists. We're deciding how much we need that. We're deciding how much oversight we need right now. Do you hear what the Spirit is saying? We get to say, I want to be important, Jesus. Great. I want you to be important. I want authority. I paid for it. Perfect, sinless blood that you would have authority forever. Will you drink the cup? Will you be baptized? Will you be a servant? The entire government, greatness in his government, is entirely based on servanthood. Entirely. There's no exceptions. Stand with me for a second if you want it. I want it. It's painful. It's not fun. But it's gloriously good. It's so different than anything the world has to offer. It is so different. It is gloriously good. It is worth it. And he makes it an easy yoke and a light burden if we'll let him. And all we have to do is say, Jesus, I don't know everything. And I'm not good at it. And I want you to lead me, Holy Spirit. If you want that, just raise your hands. We're going to ask the Holy Spirit to move through the room with fire. He reverses years in minutes. He really does. He can do it. You want him to, you open your heart, he will do it. And we just stay with it. We just guard the gate once he does it. So Holy Spirit, I'm just asking, where hearts are open, where hands are raised, send fire all over the room. Let us feel it. Let us feel the fire of your love, the wooing of the invitation to be great forever. Lord, I pray right now, you'd release ministries. Would you give pictures of you establishing forever? In the name of Jesus, I'm just asking, God, pictures, prophetic pictures of you establishing. Lord, I'm asking for a grace for antiphony in this room. Lord, I pray right now, a setting of our hearts. Would you help us? If you're saying yes to this, you're like, okay, I'm willing to commit to the antiphony, but I don't really get it totally, and I don't even know if I'm going to like it. Just tell him with your own words. I'm willing to do it. You got to help me. I'm willing to do it, Jesus. You got to help us. Holy Spirit, I'm willing. My spirit's willing. My flesh is really weak. God, would you help us to pray with you, watch with you? The watching and the praying. I hear the Holy Spirit saying, the watching and the praying a big component of that is watching yourself. What does your heart do as you pray? What does your heart do as other people pray? What does your heart do as other people sing? What does your heart do when somebody's standing in the spot that you think is for you? God, would you help us to watch and to pray? I bind the spirit of fear in Jesus' name. I cancel it right now over this people. In Jesus, I apply the blood of Jesus against the spirit of fear. Go now in Jesus' name. And I pray, Holy Spirit, release the fear of the Lord. It's clean. It's the beginning of wisdom. God, would you release the fear of the Lord in great power in this room right now? We want to feel it, God. We want to feel the cost of turning from you. Let's just worship him for a minute. If he moved your heart and you want to say anything to him, like, this mic is open. This mic is open. You know, we're really committed to that.
Just had this quick picture in my head when we all had our hands raised, and this lasted a second, but pictured Jesus himself bending over and pouring something all over to our on our raised hands. And I just want to pray into that, Father. I just pray for more, Father. I ask for hearts that are so in love with you, Father. I ask for wisdom and guidance, God. In these days, I ask for eyes wide open. I ask for ears to be hearing what you're saying to us. An intimacy, Father, with you. Because you alone satisfy. You alone are what we want. God, give us what we need, Father, to help others around us. To be that light, God. Give us courage. Give us boldness. Repent, Father, of time that we've wasted. No more. Teach our hands to war, God. In Jesus' name.
Give you my worship and all of my passion. Give you my whole heart and all my devotion. Give you my worship.
Angie was just sharing that picture that of just asking God what he was pouring out on our hands, and I just felt like he was saying that that was myrrh. And I sleep, but my heart is awake. It is the voice of my beloved. He knocks, saying, open for me, my sister, my love, my dove, my perfect one. For my head is covered with dew, my locks with the drops of the night. I have taken off my robe. How can I put it on again? I have washed my feet. How can I defile them? My beloved put his hand by the latch of the door, and my heart yearned for him. I arose to open for my beloved, and my hands dripped with myrrh, my fingers with liquid myrrh on the handles of the lock. I opened for my beloved, but my beloved had turned away and was gone. My heart leaped up when he spoke. I sought him, but I could not find him. I called him, but he gave me no answer. The watchmen who went around about the city found me. They struck me. They wounded me. The keepers of the walls, they took my veil away from me. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my beloved, that you tell him I am lovesick. He's just pouring out that myrrh on us. Our hands are at the door, and he's inviting us to open that door, to step into the searching, the longing, the lovesickness, no matter the cost. He tells us the cost, but it's for love. It's worth everything. So Lord, I just declare that I want you. I want to walk through that door each and every day to make that commitment to seeking you out no matter the cost, Lord. I just admit, and today you are convicting me about getting into a place where I feel like I'm seeing something, and that somehow that's coming from my own self, and it's just my self-assertion, my own self-seeking. When I'm reading your word, and that when I see something in it, it's my own wisdom, Lord. I'm sorry. I'm sick of saying that I repent and not actually saying that I'm sorry to you like you're in the room. I'm sorry that I'm not actually talking to you when I'm up here. I'm sorry when I'm at work and I'm just trying to line my mind up with you, and I don't actually talk to you. I'm sorry when I'm speaking to other people and all I can think about is how I can show them or tell them or assert that I'm trying to follow you instead of actually listening to you and speaking what you're saying. I'm sorry for hearing something that you tell me and then trying to make it happen on my own. I'm sorry for not waiting on you when you give me a word, for being impatient, or for trying to figure out the right way, or the, if I would only do this, then this would happen, Lord. I'm sorry for taking the things that you've given me and voluntarily giving them up for something else, Lord. I'm done with that. I'm done with that. I'm done asserting my own self. I'm done asserting my own way. I'm done. I yield, Lord. Have your way. I want your way. Lord, I love you.
Jesse just opened up like a huge pathway. And we could draft in that right now. If you want that, just respond to the Lord. Anything that Jesse was praying, like you want to touch that, just like raise your hand or just tell him, like somehow respond. I'm just going to pray it over us. Holy Spirit, just release, Lord, that grace for honesty with you. Would you release that grace for repentance over us as a people, Lord, as a community of people chasing after Jesus? I'm asking, Lord, our hearts are open. Would you just touch us? Lord, would you touch us right now with renewal? Would you touch us right now with the fire of love sickness, the fire of actually desiring our